Good morning, River Hills Church. Oh my gosh, if you only had a picture of what happens in this last few minutes before that camera goes live, you would definitely enjoy the show that goes on. We have some good news this morning. We've got a new phone number to call in for dial-in worship. And hopefully this morning, those people participating in that way will find a new way that actually gives them a much better sound feed into their phone so they can actually hear some of the music. In the past, we were having difficulties with that. We found a way to actually be able to put the actual live stream audio into the phone signal. So hopefully that's going to work a whole lot better for our folks out there. I want to welcome you this morning to River Hills Church. It's good to gather together in the name of God. For God promises whenever two or more are gathered in God's name, God will be with us. And I believe through the Holy Spirit, throughout all the distances that we have right now, God will be with us in this time of worship. Let us prepare our hearts as we come together. I'm just going to call us into this time of worship. Be with us, O Lord. Gather us in your hearts and in your names. Let us find a joyful place in our hearts to be able to share. But let us also bring our whole selves. For there are parts of us that might be hurting, parts of us that might be lonely, parts of us that might be yearning for coming back together again. You are with us all. You bridge that gap. So let us come together and worship today. Let's join together in our first hymn, All Things Bright and Beautiful. Things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. Each little flower that opens, each little bird that sings, He made their glowing colors, He made their tiny wings. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. God gave us eyes to see them, and lips that we might tell how great is God Almighty, who has made all things well. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. God gave us eyes to see them, and lips that we might tell how great is God Almighty, who has made all things well. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. Amen. Let us keep that first and foremost on our mind. This week, as we were preparing for worship, I had an opportunity to view a piece of art, a video that was created that I thought I would share with you today. I want to give you a little bit of background so that you have the sense that this is somebody that, though you may not know this person, you have a connection to them. Adam Swanson is the grandson of the person who was my mentor and my pastor when I entered into ministry. Adam was encouraged to enter into a video creation around how the COVID-19, the coronavirus epidemic, is affecting him. And, you know, sometimes it's good for us to recognize the way things are in the world today. And what struck me by his video was that it was a great piece of storytelling with some beautiful visuals, but it also gave us each an opportunity to ask us, how are these days affecting us? And I hope you find it both reflectional and inspirational. I want to turn your attention now to Adam Swanson's piece called A Changed World.
My name is Adam, and these are my circumstances during the COVID-19 pandemic. Let's rewind the clock. December 2019. I was getting ready to leave Alaska. I lived in Juneau for about 10 months. Living and working in Juneau was unreal, to say the least. I worked as a photography guide and had some incredible experiences. Experience that, for most people, come around only once in a lifetime. I saw landscapes that made me cry, had close encounters with wild animals that reminded me of how small we are. It was nothing short of one of the best times of my life. And now I'm here, back in New Jersey, where I grew up. Coming back here was meant to be a stopgap, an in-between, till I figure out what's next. But now, I'm stuck. We're all stuck. Every human. Stuck in this seemingly never-ending doom and gloom between the media and our own thoughts. Although the streets are quiet, the world actually seems a bit louder. News programs spitting out stories and reports nonstop all about this virus. Some hopeful, some frightening. There never seems to be time for us, now, and by us I mean each other. We may be physically separate for now, and it'll probably be a while until we can physically be near each other again. Many of us are separated from our jobs, our families, our friends, our loved ones. But if there's one thing I know, it's that we all feel this way. We're all dealing with this pandemic in one way or another. Some have it easier, and some have it far worse, but it affects us all. So to those of you that are feeling alone, distant, lost even, like your world has come to a screeching halt, know that you are not alone. I believe we will get through this and come out the other end better. So, until we can see each other again in person, stay home, stay safe, and take care of each other.
We truly are in this together, and we truly do want you to stay home, stay safe, and know that you are not alone. There's a whole world out there that God has created for us, that God is still loving us through. And no matter what your experience might be today, we are invited to bring it to God in prayer. We've had some folks in our congregation that have lost loved ones this week, not due directly to the COVID-19 virus, but I do have to wonder just how much it has affected those who are in nursing homes and extended care, those who already find their medical situation fragile. I invite you to be that voice of connection, of hope, of peace, and of love to those people in your community. Please keep the Potter family in your prayers as they've lost, Denise lost her father-in-law this week. Also, Karen Spiker, I just ask you to keep her in your prayers. Her mother passed away. Karen is in the process of pulling together a service for her mom, and we are there to do whatever we can to support her in that process. Sometimes it may be just a listening ear. Sometimes it may be some good advice. We found ourselves in the same situation with Denise's family, but we're thankful that there was a pastor in that community that was connected to her father-in-law and was able to have just a small family graveside service for him this week. There are others in our community that are undergoing questions and tests, waiting for test results, waiting for tests to happen. You know who you are. Know that your community and your faith community is with you, surrounding you in our love and our prayers, lifting you up. And please know that though you may be quite lonely, you are not alone, that we are with you. We also have some celebrations that occurred this week as there were some new children born in our community, some grandchildren, and we also had some good test results come back and some people that were relieved, people that came out of the hospital, all good things. So we want to focus on those as well and give thanks to God. Let us find ourselves now in an attitude of prayer, and I invite you to join with me in today's community prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, we gather together this morning to say we believe. We cast our doubts at the foot of the cross, at the mouth of the empty tomb. We're here to have our faith strengthened and our hope renewed. Meet us as we come together to worship the one who died, but who now lives. Let us continue in prayer. O God of all things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, we come to you in this time of prayer, opening our hearts, knowing that as we do so, that the love that we share with you, we also share with one another, as you called us to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love our neighbors in the same way. Lord, it's difficult at times. To find that loving place on our difficult days. But let us know that we are not alone in those difficult days, that as we might struggle, as we might wish that things were different, that some things have not changed, and that is your ever-faithful, ongoing, eternal, and continuous love that you have for all of your children. Oh God, on this day we had hoped to celebrate confirmation. As we have 7 of our young people that have been going to class and have been growing in their faith and sharing with one another what it means to confirm those baptismal vows that were given to them, the sanctuary feels a bit more empty than it normally would. But Lord, we know that you are holding space for that time of celebration. You know that this is not a moot point, that we are here to be with you. And so we celebrate knowing that there will be the day when we gather together again and we are able to celebrate these things. Lord, lift up our confirmation students and their families. Help them to get through this place of disappointment and instead be waiting expectantly for what is to come. We also know that in the next few weeks, we're going to have a number of our people that are graduating from college and from high school, those fifth graders that are moving up to junior high, and those eighth graders or ninth graders that are moving up to high school, those kindergartners that get to go to first grade. And while they wish more than anything they could gather together with their friends, again, Lord, plant within their hearts and their souls not a sense of disappointment, but a sense of expectation. For this too shall pass, and they will have a time of celebration and new beginning. Lord, you are a God who surprises us. And even when we least expect it, you are present with us. So, Lord, help us. Open our eyes and open our hearts in such a way that we might be surprised by how your love comes through to us today. Help us to be surprised by the opportunities that we might have to share your love with one another. And that a life of service, even in a time of isolation, is possible. So, Lord, help us to find those ways and help us to be renewed. May our strength be renewed. We lift all of this up to you, Almighty God, in Jesus' name, who, when we needed to pray, he taught his disciples to pray in this way: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So it's time for the children's sermon, but I just want to give you a little warning. You may not recognize the person who's giving the children's sermon today, but stay tuned in. I need some kids!
Hello, friends. Do you know who this is? I bet you can't guess. Pretty amazing disguise, right? Huh? Huh? Okay, maybe it's not a great disguise. Maybe you knew who I was all along. Maybe you knew by the sound of my voice. Or maybe because you expected me to be here. You probably knew all along. Well, today, in today's gospel lesson, we learned all about a similar situation where some of Jesus' friends were walking down the road. They were on their way to a place called Emmaus. And all of a sudden, Jesus was walking with them. But they didn't know it was Jesus. Now, I don't know if they didn't know it was him because he looked different after the resurrection, or they weren't expecting him to be there, but they didn't recognize who it was. And they started talking about the death of their beloved friend Jesus. And Jesus knew they were talking about him. And he starts to tell them all the things that prophets said many, many years ago, foretelling that a Messiah would be coming, and the Messiah would be crucified, and that would rise again from the dead. And they still didn't know that it was Jesus. When they got in closer to town, they went to have a meal, and they invited Jesus to come in with them. And at that meal, Jesus breaks bread and gives it to them, just like he did at the Last Supper. And that's when their eyes were opened, and they recognized that it was Jesus, and they were overjoyed. Sometimes things that happen in our own lives are kind of disguised, and we don't recognize them. But one thing we need to remember is that God is always at work in our lives through other people, always for the good. So no matter how disguised something seems, or how troubled, or how wrong, or how hard, or how difficult, we should always look for the ways that God is working through other people to reach out to everyone in the world. So remember that. Always look for the blessings in disguise and always be looking for Jesus. And today I have a craft. There's no toilet paper in the store, so that tells me there's gotta be some empty rolls around. So I hope you can find an empty roll. All you need are two pieces of tube. You could roll up some paper. I cut a bunch of pieces off of a long gift wrap roll. And then you can have an adult or an older sibling help you get a snip a hole into each side. And you can use some yarn to tie it together for a string, and you can tape them together. And then I put a little extra piece in the middle of mine to make mine wider. So there's your craft. Go out this week and look for God. All right, friends, let's say a prayer. Dear God, thank you for sending us Jesus. Thank you for helping us trust you even when we don't understand what's happening. Be with us this week as we look for ways that you work in our lives. Amen. I'll see you next week, friends.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. A little tired of being the only one singing Jesus Loves Me, but we're going to continue to do it because I think it's a really important message that we need to hear every week, that simple little promise. But I want to invite you to go ahead, and if you have one of those phones that can take a video, just take a video of you or somebody you love singing Jesus Loves Me and send it on in. We would love to let that be a part of worship, and it'll be a great gift for you to give to somebody else. Think about it. Give it a try. We would love to be able to do that. Speaking of loving to be able to do things, we have a very special scripture reader today. It is a longtime member from the time she was just little. Ruthie Olson is joining us all the way from Portland, Oregon, the University of Portland. She graduates actually from college this Saturday, which I'm going to also use this as a little bit of an encouragement. If you're the kind of person that might like to send a card to somebody who's graduating, we need to know who you are so we can get those addresses and those names to you, because on behalf of this church, we would love to fill up their email, their mailboxes, with great greetings and help them be able to celebrate, because their ability to celebrate is going to be pretty limited this year. But we'd like to be a part of that. So if that's something you'd be willing to do, send us an email. Again, you can always send it just right to the church at River Hills at riverhillsumc.com. Again, it's easy enough. River Hills at riverhillsumc.com. We'd love to hear from you and share this. I'm going to turn it over to Ruthie. She's also got a special announcement to make, so listen close to her introduction. Ruthie?
Hi, friends. Greetings from Portland, Oregon. This is Ruthie Olson. I am a soon-to-be college graduate from the University of Portland. I grew up at River Hills Church, where I was surrounded by a loving community that helped me to understand the important role that church can play in our journey through life. While the church is currently in a time of growth and change, I found God working on my heart as to the role I am called to play. It is with a bit of excitement, maybe a lot, and a healthy dose of fear that I share with you today that I've committed to pursuing a Master of Divinity and a Master of Social Work at Boston University beginning this fall. Pastor Robert shared with me that today was Confirmation Sunday at River Hills. For those of you going through confirmation, I want you to be sure that God's got you in their arms, holding you tight, and I hope you're excited about the journey before you, even though it probably won't look like the one you have planned. Personally, I never imagined that when I stood before River Hills Church, confirming my baptismal vows 7 years ago, that I would be considering serving in the ordained ministry. Please hold me in your heart as I hold River Hills in mine for the journey ahead. It is my delight to be sharing with you the scripture today. First, I am reading from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 17 through 23, as we are reminded to focus not on this world, but on the ways of God. If you invoke as Father the one who judges all people impartially according to their deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without defect or blemish. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end of the ages for your sake. Through him you have come to trust in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are set on God. Now that you have purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, so that you have genuine mutual love, love one another deeply from the heart. You have been born anew, not of perishable, but of imperishable seed, through the living and enduring word of God. The gospel lesson is from Luke, chapters 24, verses 13 through 35. This is one of my favorite stories, and it is a story of a journey that ends with open hearts, open minds, and open doors. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all the things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told them what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of bread. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
It just fills my heart to be able to hear Ruthie share those words and that encouragement and that story of journey. I want to have you take a look at the altar today. On the communion table, we have this beautiful design put together by Melissa Miller. As she wanted to somehow represent the fact that this was Confirmation Sunday, but it's not Confirmation Sunday. We're going to be waiting till sometime this fall to be able to do it, so hopefully we can do it together again. But in the meantime, we're holding space, we're holding a place, we're leaving room for what God has in store for us. So I invite you to with that attitude of leaving space in your life for what God might have possible for you, let's join together in this song as we prepare for today's word. May the words from my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So, how has your journey looked this week? What has it been like? You may not have ventured far from the very familiar places. I don't know about you, but I have a difficult time remembering what day of the week it is sometimes. And so it's good to come together on Sunday to kind of give an anchor to the rest of the week. May today's worship be an anchor, not something that holds you down, but something that grounds you, that keeps you in place. Journeying is a difficult thing. And the walk to Emmaus is both a familiar journey as well as one that if we listen to it with new ears, we might hear new things. Particularly in this time and in this place that was once held aside for confirmation. What is confirmation? What does it mean to confirm our faith? You know, it's let's turn to that story of the walk to Emmaus. Because that confirming is part of our journey. It's not the end of our journey. It's just simply part of our journey that is a little bit different than the other parts. This faith thing, we oftentimes look at it as something fairly monolithic. You either have it or don't have it. That's not the way it works. When the men started walking to Emmaus to gather with the other disciples, they were going over the day's events. That's something that we do often. We go over with loved ones the day's events. So, honey, how was your day? What was going on? What's new? And we listen to what's going on. Now the amazing part about this journey is that this is the same day that The women had gone to the tomb and found the stone was rolled away and the tomb was empty. So often when we read this Emmaus story, we read it weeks after Easter, but this is the same day. It's happening all at the same time. They're walking along, wondering about the day's events, how this could possibly have happened. How could God be present in this turn of events? And yes, they had heard that maybe he was still alive, but they had to figure it out for themselves. They start the journey by being very present in the world around them, being aware of the things that are going on. That's where we start our faith journey. Not stepping aside from the world as we know it, but engaging the world as we know it, to try to understand it and to make sense. Understanding, reflecting, is the beginning of the process. What are you trying to understand these days? What are your conversations looking like? Is it a part of your journey of faith? And like the men that day, they didn't even realize what might be in store. The next thing that came along was this stranger. It says in the scripture that they didn't recognize who it might be. It says, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. Now, so often we just kind of attribute that their eyes were kept from recognizing him to some kind of a God thing, that God somehow masked, put a disguise on Jesus so that the people wouldn't recognize him. But it doesn't say that. It just simply says they were kept from recognizing. What kept them from recognizing Jesus in their midst? I'll tell you in my years of ministry that can be attributed to a lot of things, and often it isn't God trying to play tricks on us. Oftentimes what keeps us from recognizing God in our presence are the things that we're carrying around. It's oftentimes our grief or our anger, our frustration, how we are upset about not having control over the situation that we're in the midst of. When things don't turn out the way we thought they should, that becomes a mask that keeps us from seeing how God is acting anew in our lives. God isn't masking God's work. We're allowing the world, we're allowing our emotions, we're allowing the things in our life to get in the way, to keep us from recognizing how God is working in our life. That needs to change, and it does for these journeyers as well. I love how it starts off when this stranger comes to them and asks them a simple question. What are you discussing with each other while you walk along? See, God cares about the things that are on our hearts and on our minds. God really does care about the things that we're talking about how our day is going, about the things that we're challenged by. God cares. Do we give room for God caring about us in the midst of our lives? Do we give room for God to care about the things that are important to us? I'm going to encourage you to recognize that God definitely does care. God cares about the things that are important to us. The question is, what's important to you? And what are you putting first and foremost? Is that what you want to be a part of your witness? About how you are walking in faith? Again, I don't say that with any sense of judgment, because some days are better than others. Yes, your pastor has good days and bad days. There's days that I just need to go to bed to start a new day. I had one of those days this week. It was difficult. It was challenging. Things weren't playing out the way I had thought they should or that they would. And I became very frustrated. I needed a new day to begin so that I could put the old day behind me. God cares about the things that we are talking about, just like in this walk to Emmaus. Now, what's fascinating is these people who are journeying with Jesus, what's their first response when he asks a question? They almost reply with a little bit of disdain. They stood still, looking at him, looking sad. And then they said to him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" Sometimes we try to put God in God's place. It doesn't work. God understands all too well the things that are going on in our world. And even though they tried, Jesus goes on to tell them so much more. He first asks what things, and they explain to them what's going on in their life. And then Jesus opens up their hearts to the rest of the story, the rest of God's plan, the rest of the way that God is working through this tragic event to come with something new for the people of God. Later on, they report that their hearts were burning at this time as he's explaining these things. There was some truth that was coming to it. Are we listening to how God is sharing with us what is new in our world? Or are we just ready to dismiss it and put it in some other place? Now, the other important part of this is that they continue to journey with Jesus. That heart-warming, heart-burning piece is kind of the second step in our journey of faith. First, we try to understand based on the world around us. But then we affirm. We affirm what is true, what we find to be true and real in this world. It's important for us to be affirmational in our lives. And sometimes those affirmations take place in sharing our thanksgiving and appreciation for the work that others have done to make our lives better. That's a good witness to have. It's affirming that what they're doing is making a difference. Who have you affirmed this week? Keep that in mind. That's part of the journey of faith. Understanding the world that we live in and affirming those parts that are by God's grace and God's love, providing God's hope, providing us some truth. Affirm those things in our lives. It says they continued to invite Jesus along and then invited him to come and stay with them. There is a part of this process, this journey, in which we need to be willing to be invitational. We need to invite God to be a part of our lives. We need to open ourselves up and open that door for God to enter in, even when we're not too sure that it's God. Open ourselves up for God to be a part of our lives. We need to be invitational. We need to understand, we need to affirm, and we need to invite. And then it was in that moment, just a common, ordinary, everyday moment in which they sat down to eat. It says that Jesus took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it. And it was in the breaking of the bread that their eyes were open. It was in the everyday common element of their life that they were able to see Jesus with new eyes. You see how that almost makes a full circle? That we begin to understand the world around us in a new way In a new way, they were able to see Jesus in the breaking of the bread. Now, we kind of lose that commonness of this understanding because we're so used to, as people of faith, oftentimes doing communion. So we understand that in the breaking of the bread, something special happens. But in this moment, there was none of that expectation. In fact, it's most likely that the people that he was breaking bread with weren't even a part of that, what we come to call the Last Supper. But yet in that common blessing and breaking of bread, Jesus is made real. And yes, just at that moment, it almost seems unfair that then Jesus disappears from their sight. You see, God has done God's work in that place. God has made Jesus revealed in their lives, has inspired them to help them move on. And once they are able to see Jesus, Jesus can no longer be seen in their present. They must live out their life. And this, my friends, is what I consider kind of that fourth step, and that is the confirming part of our faith. We understand the world around us. We affirm the way God is working with us. We invite God to be a part of our lives. And then when we see Jesus' face, it's the opportunity for us to confirm what we believe. We're not just affirming the faith. We're not just trying to understand the faith. We're not even just inviting the church to be a part of our lives. We're confirming that we want this to be a part of our journey so that we live it out. Do you understand that? What is it for you in your week? What is it for you in your journey that you will follow this path? And will you end in that place of confirmation? Of not just simply saying yes, but saying it is who I am. It is part of me. Now, for those of you who might be looking at me going, are you kidding, Pastor? I've got so many questions and so many doubts. There are other stories that follow that are affirm the fact that even the best of the disciples had their own doubts, had their own questions, had their own wondering. And I like the way this particular story ends because they go back to the other disciples and they tell them, they confirm that Jesus was present with them, and they also hear that Jesus had been made known to Simon. And in that, I'm hearing that Jesus is available to everybody, not just the leaders, not just to the called, but to everyone. In our different gospels, we show Jesus making appearances to many different people, from the women at the tomb to the men who went fishing. Jesus makes his presence known. I invite you this week to continue on that journey of faith, to get to that point of confirmation, to confirm that what you do believe is a part of your life. But don't think that that's the end of the journey because it starts all over again. Again, remember, it's understanding the world around us, paying attention to what's going on. It's affirming the good things that are happening in our lives. It's also taking that step of inviting that faith, inviting that presence, inviting Christ to be a part of our lives, and then confirming that you want to be a part of that journey. And then I think it starts all over again. From that point of confirmation, we begin to understand the world around us in some new ways. We begin to affirm new things. We begin to invite God in different parts of our life that maybe we held separate to try to keep a hold of some things that weren't ready to let go and let God do a new thing. And then confirm by living out that faith, and then it starts all over again. Brothers and sisters in Christ, this is the story, this is the journey. I invite you to come along with your church on this journey of faith. Wherever you might be starting, that's okay. And let's pray for one another as we find this journey together. We lift this up in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's pray. Oh, gracious God, we give thanks for the journey that's before us. It's our journey. No one else has a journey like it. Let us do our best to engage that journey, to not let our eyes be kept from recognizing what is before us, but to cast away our fear, cast away our doubt, cast away the things that are keeping us from recognizing you. Lord, be with us today, in Jesus' name, amen. So I invite you to the next part of the service, which is our time of offering. I want us to say a word of thanks for all those who have generously been continuing their contributions to the church that allow us to make this happen, for the special gifts that are coming in to allow us to do this broadcast in a quality manner. Thank you. But I also, as you know, believe this time of offering is more than just about money. It's about our time, it's about our talents, and it's about the way we serve God in new and different ways. It's about the story we share. So I invite you, as you listen to this piece that Kathleen has prepared for us, to use this time in a time of reflection to consider what God is calling you to offer in this world today. Thank you. we close our worship service today, I invite you to join with me in a tune that many of you find very familiar. Normally, I try to keep the number of verses we sing for online worship just to a couple of verses, but this song, there wasn't a verse that I could possibly cut out. Let's join together as we sing, "How Great Thou Art."
How great thou art,
and sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Brothers and sisters in Christ, go forth. Go forth to your week, to your journey, to the place that God is leading you and guiding you. God has put you on this journey for a reason and for a purpose. Be aware. Be aware of how God might reveal God's self to you in the normal, everyday experiences of your week. Proclaim it, claim it, and confirm it in your witness, in your story, and how you live this life. Brothers and sisters in Christ, be kind to yourself this week and gracious to others. Go now in peace. Amen.